Atmospheric pressure is the driving force behind weather on Earth. From the everyday to the extreme. And it's pushing down on you right now. At sea level, it's bearing down on your body at about 14.5 pounds per square inch.
In the simplest terms, atmospheric pressure is the weight of the air on top of you. The more air on top of you, the stronger the atmospheric pressure.
Where is all this weight coming from? Air may look like empty space, but it's really an invisible ocean of molecules, mostly oxygen and nitrogen. There are roughly 10 quintillion of them in every cubic centimeter of air. It's this ocean of air we call our atmosphere, and the weight of all those tiny molecules combines to create atmospheric pressure.
So when you think of air, you don't think it weighs anything because you don't feel anything, but everything has mass, even if it's an air molecule.
Why are we crushed by this weight? There's an equal outward pressure being exerted by all the tissue, air, blood, water, and everything else we're made of.
So we have the pressure inside of us, and then of course we have the atmosphere, and they basically cancel each other out.
But what part does atmospheric pressure play in our weather?
Basically, pressure is changing. It's constantly changing. The sun doesn't actually heat the Earth evenly. So you'll have pockets of warm. That's when you have the rising air, and that's low pressure.
Rising warm air carries water vapor upwards, leaving lower air pressure at the Earth's surface. This water vapor condenses into clouds, and that can lead to precipitation.
Your snowstorms, your blizzards, your hurricanes, even your thunderstorms, they're all low pressure systems because the air is rising and condensing.
On the other end of the spectrum, in a high pressure system, cooler air falls and warms as it descends. Air pressure at the surface increases.
Warmer air rises, lower pressure. Colder air sinks, higher pressure.
Earth is always trying to equalize these areas of high and low pressure, and that's where the action begins.
When you get the transfer of air from high pressure to low pressure, that's how you get wind.
Moisture is getting transported with the wind, so these high pressure and low pressure systems are really what's driving weather across the world.
The ultimate low pressure systems are tropical cyclones.
In the Atlantic, we call them hurricanes. In the Western Pacific, they're known as typhoons, and in the Indian Ocean, they get referred to as cyclones. They're all the same type of system, but in the Northern Hemisphere, they spin counterclockwise, and in the Southern Hemisphere, they spin clockwise.
By any name, they're the most powerful and destructive storms on the planet. But how is their power unlocked? Atlantic hurricanes often spawn from atmospheric disturbances coming off the African continent and moving into warm tropical water.
You need water temperatures of 80 degrees Fahrenheit or above.
Heat from the sun evaporates the warm seawaters, with further evaporation being driven by the wind. As the warm air rises, carrying water vapor high up in the atmosphere, it condenses and forms storm clouds. The rising air indicates the pressure is dropping near the sea surface. Due to interactions with Earth's rotational forces, the winds begin to circulate around the low pressure eye at the center of the storm. A monster is born.
So when you have the clearing out of the eye of a hurricane, that's the air sinking from the outflow of the thunderstorms that are around it. So the air is coming down. Eventually, though, it gets pulled back up into the thunderstorms. So it's really kind of this engine that's just keeping the air circulating over and over and over again. And that's why you just have that calm that's in the center of the storm.
Hurricanes are categorized by one violent measure, maximum sustained winds. Once they reach 74 miles per hour, a hurricane is classified as Category 1.
You know, even a Category 1 hurricane is devastating.
As winds increase to 111 miles per hour, a storm becomes a major Category 3 hurricane. At 157 miles per hour, it reaches the rarefied realm of a Cat 5 beast.
Usually it's catastrophic damage.
Damage from tropical cyclones can extend for thousands of miles, especially during huge storms like Typhoon Tip, which made landfall in Japan in 1979. With peak wind gusts of 190 miles per hour, Tip was the largest tropical cyclone ever seen on Earth, measuring almost 1,400 miles in diameter as it churned across the Pacific. If it were in the Atlantic, it would have stretched from Boston to the Florida Keys.
Tip also set another record. With the exception of a tornado, the Eye of Tip generated the lowest pressure ever recorded on Earth at 870 millibars.
Wind is just one part of a tropical cyclone's monstrous wrath. Intense rain can bring flooding far inland, while at the coast, raging storm surge may engulf entire towns.
It's just utter devastation for the communities that live there. Everything's pretty much wiped out.
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration is gathering data from dozens of new technologies to improve hurricane forecasting and save lives.
We've been always trying to improve our ability to provide forecast guidance. When I first started, you know, a lot of the tools we had were strictly an aircraft with a sensor for temperature, humidity, pressure, and wind on board. And so those processes needed to be improved. So we came up with ideas to look at the surface better. The ocean is a big player.
Traditionally, aircraft have deployed dropsondes, sensor-filled cylinders to study the storm.
It's traveling from 40,000 feet all the way to the splash of the ocean surface, capturing that vertical profile data, temperature, humidity, wind speed, wind direction, all the great things.
But in 2022, at the same time sail drones were studying Hurricane Ian at the surface, NOAA deployed something more advanced than a dropsonde, its own aerial drone, the Altius 600. Upon release, the drone unfolded its 8-foot wingspan and flew into the eye of the hurricane, collecting pressure, temperature, and moisture readings.
It worked great. It flew for about 90 minutes, and the data is phenomenal.
The drone even descended to as low as 2,000 feet above the surface and flew through the eye wall, recording winds of 216 miles per hour.
Having new technology like uncrewed aerial systems in the ocean and in the air, that is giving us a new picture of how we can better understand hurricanes and improve the forecast.